Hi, welcome back to the Smarky Show. This is episode 3. Today we're talking about travel, we're talking about blogging, as Suman is with us today and she is a travel blogger. Hi to everybody who's joining in. I'll very soon, in about a minute or so, Suman is joining us. Suman is a psychology teacher. She's been teaching for a long time now. Plus, she writes, she travels and she writes and she gets paid for it. That is why she's here today. Okay, so let me look for Suman and then we'll start speaking to her. For all the people who have joined here, thank you very much for joining. There. Waiting for nomadic shoes. That is her handle that she goes by.
Hi,
Hi Suman!
hello, how are you?
Finally! Good, how are you?
Finally, I'm good, I'm good. You tell me.
So everybody, welcome Suman, Suman aka, actually it is Nomadic Shoes aka Suman. So this is the face behind the articles and all the write-ups and everything. So welcome.
Thank
Before
you.
we
Thank
start,
you.
okay,
Yeah.
Suman, tell us a little bit about yourself and then we'll start with the questions.
You're starting with such a difficult question, huh? Okay,
Ha
I am a psychology teacher. I've been teaching for the past 10 years now, and my love for traveling started after I, started working in the school. And I've been traveling for the past 8 years, and I've been writing for the past 8 years. But
Oh, okay.
professionally, as a blogger, it's only like 4 or 5 years back that I started giving it like a serious thought, and I started writing as a, as a professional blogger.
Since you're talking about professional blogger, when do you say that now this is a profession? What is that point?
See, I think when it starts generating revenue for you, at that time you can say, okay, you're doing it as a professional blogger. I would still not call myself as a professional blogger because I'm not generating like a lot of revenues. So that's like a reality check that I want to give to everybody. See, I started blogging as something which I like doing. So traveling was something I really enjoyed, and I was going to places which people never heard of. So I wanted to tell people about my experiences and show them the kind of India that they have never seen. So that drove me to write about traveling. And so far, I have done a lot of collaboration, barter, and even some revenue generation. But I won't say that I generate like a lot of revenue from it because I'm also a little bit irregular because obviously, with family, with work, and my personal traveling, I don't want to do it professionally because it takes away the fun out of it. That's what I feel.
Yes, we have some questions about that also.
Yes.
Since you're talking about the your kind of destinations, even in your blog, you write, you visit all these very off-grid kind of places where usually the mainstream people, they don't go there. They don't even know about these places. How do you find these places? How do you boil down? And how do you make it happen? And why these places?
See, there's not a lot of thought going, like, in terms of, okay, where I'm going to go. So it's like, if I come across a place which a friend mentioned or I saw it on social media, so I would, I search more on that and I go there. And also while traveling, you meet a lot of locals and you talk to them, know about their lives. So many times I have picked up places from them. So they have suggested. So I always usually ask the locals, where would you want us to go, or what experience do you think I will enjoy? How do you live? What do you do to chill? Things like that.
One of the questions here we got from our you viewers is one thing you should always do when you travel, even whether it is off-grid or it is mainstream travel destinations. One thing you should always do as a traveler or as a travel enthusiast.
See, one thing very difficult to say because for everybody the priorities can be different. What I do is I always inform, so my husband knows that where I am, where I'm going. So I share where I'm going to stay and the phone number of that person. Now, off-grid or on-grid, me and my husband, we share a Google location also. Mm-hmm. So that way, you know, we don't have to call each other all the time. So he knows if he wants to check up on me, he knows where I am. So that is something that we both do. Other than that, anything related to traveling, wherever you're going, it's a request. It's a humble request to everybody. Don't throw your, you know, garbage. Just bring them with you. So when you're in the mountains or, you know, when you're going to somebody else, it's like, you know, you're going to somebody else's home. So when we go to a relative's house or friend's house, do we mess it up? We don't, right? Huh. So even when we are going to, you know, to a new place, we should not litter. We should, you know, take care of that. Huh. So sustainability will go a long way. So that is something I'm very conscious about. I don't buy bottled water. So I always carry my own water bottle. And I have a checklist. So before going, I usually, you know, check. You know, what are the things I need to carry with myself and things like that. So these few things that I always keep in mind.
So organizing beforehand definitely helps being definitely. More mindful about the place that you're visiting.
Definitely, definitely. Because see, what happens if I'm not mindful, when I'm thirsty, I'm bound to buy water from outside. But if I'm already prepared and if I already know that, you know, obviously when I'm traveling, I'm going to drink water. So if I carry my own bottle, so what I do is when I'm traveling, I refill my water wherever, you know, if we are in a restaurant, I will fill it up from there. Or if I'm in a hotel before leaving in the morning, I will refill. So, you know, instead of buying, you can just refill. So, yeah, a lot of thought has to go. You have to be consciously aware that, you know, you don't want to do it. So that ways.
Yeah. Okay. What to focus on most during travel for a travel blog?
Travel blog. See, we all, you know, all the travel bloggers, they all have their niche, you know, what they want to write about. So I prefer writing about culture. I have been very inclined about writing about tribes and things like that. So whenever I'm traveling, I try to observe these little things which will expose me to the culture of that particular place. So instead of, you know, going to the most famous place in a tourist destination, I would not do it. I would, you know, rather talk to people and, you know, I would prefer to go to their home and, you know, prefer to stay in a homestay. So that local culture you get to know. So
How do you manage the language when you go
See,
to such
for
places?
Me, in India, it has not been a problem till now.
Okay.
So, you know, most of the people, they talk, they understand a bit of Hindi or at least some English, right? And even when you're unable to do it, yeah, it is a problem, but you can have a basic conversation, you know, even, you know, like I remember once we were in Kerala and we were traveling in a local train and we were supposed to get down at a particular station and we didn't know because everything was written in Malayalam. So we asked somebody, managed to, you know, convey that we want to get down at this place and we slept. And those, you know, those sweet ladies, they were so nice. They woke us up and they said, you know, your station is there. Now, obviously not in language, but, you know, they understood us and we understood them. So it's more like, you know, understanding and respecting people. Like I can't say, oh, you don't speak Hindi, so I'm not going to talk to you. At least give it a try.
Okay. How to get some fresh air when we feel anxious, especially now during quarantine?
I'm watching a lot of movies.
Oops.
So, you know, all the, you know, I'm missing traveling so much because I think this has been the longest since I went out. Like it's been already 2.5 months. And so I'm just satisfying, you know, my wanderlust by watching movies or writing about travel. But on a more serious note, to get fresh air, I go for a walk every night. So after dinner, I go for a walk. We just roam around, me and my husband roam around near our sector inside the apartment and doing some exercise. I'm following yoga these days. So that has helped me, you know, to become more calm. And earlier, I never used to, you know, believe in meditation or yoga and things like that. But once I have started doing it, yeah, I can see that it has calmed me down.
It has. A lot of us have started valuing a lot of things which we were taking so much for granted earlier, no? Before all of
definitely,
this.
Definitely.
Okay. Your journey as a travel blogger, you have touched a little bit on this, but what are the what are those called? Pit stops in your journey.
Okay, like the places that I have enjoyed visiting, are you asking
me
that?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have covered like a lot of India. So I have done almost 27 states so far. And some of my favorite places are in the Northeast. So I love the Northeast. So especially, you know, Arunachal Pradesh. I visited Tripura. Tripura was amazing. Then I have done Kerala also extensively. And Himachal, obviously, it's very close to my heart. So even a weekend off, I would always run away to Himachal. So these are some places, but the best experiences that I've had till now, as I mentioned before, that I explored a bit of tribal culture. So last year I attended the Bastar Dashera that happens in Chhattisgarh. So that was very new and very different, you know. That was like a culture I have never seen before, because for us, Dashera is, you know, what we celebrate as Navratri in the north northern part of India, or what we celebrate in Bengal, Durga Puja. But in Chhattisgarh, it was amazing because it was from a tribal perspective. So they celebrate during the same days, but the whole, you know, reason why they are celebrating is very different. So that was very new for me. That was very interesting. Then a few years back, I attended one festival in Arunachal Pradesh in a place called Yazali. Again, it was a tribal community which I explored. So these have been some of the good experiences that I've had, and obviously trekking also.
Do you travel alone or do you usually prefer a group?
I hate groups, to be very honest. I can't travel with more than, you know, more than three people. That is like my saturation point. More than that, then, you know, it becomes very difficult for me. And I hate traveling with friends.
Why?
Why?
Because, give us the reasons.
Oh, I have so many reasons I can't tell you.
Don't get into trouble.
My friends know that. So usually what happens when we are traveling with friends, you end up, you know, first nobody decides what they want to do, and then everybody wants to do everything. So it's a lot of, you know, decision making happening, and I don't like to depend on other people for that decision making. If I want to do something, because my way of traveling is very different from my friends. So, you know, when I'm spending so much money to travel to a destination, I want to do what I want to do, right? I don't want to depend on other people. I don't want to sit in the hotel and, you know, have coffee. I want to go out. I want to see the sunrise in the morning, you know. You know, those kind of things. So, when you're traveling on your own, or even, I enjoy traveling with strangers. I have traveled with a lot of people that I don't know or only knew over social media. And I have made very good friends with them after we have traveled. So, you know, because there is a respect and there is, you know, a lot of space that these people have given to me. So that is why.
As a woman traveler, even as a solo woman traveler, what are the risks one should be prepared for? Because we have many viewers who are young girls who want to travel. But of course, we are answerable to parents, and nobody right now feels very comfortable just letting their girls go here and there, especially with strangers, like you said. But you have been experienced now almost a decade of traveling. So what risks are there? How should we prepare for them?
See, it's like any risk that I might take when I go from my home to my college or to my school. You know, when you're traveling, the same kind of risk are there. The biggest risk that we as women face in India is eve-teasing, or, you know, the male gaze, you know, those kind of things. And that will happen everywhere. It's just not that, you know, when you're traveling, it will only happen with you. But it'll happen everywhere. So that is one thing that you have to deal with. What I do is, I have my game face on, you know, whenever I'm traveling. So I will have a very, you know, like a very rowdy kind of face, so that people will be scared of me, and, you know, they will not talk to me. And sometimes I become very rude, and, you know, I think it has helped me to show that a little bit of aggression when I'm traveling around, not like when I'm talking to other people, but just have that kind of face. So, you know, people don't mess with you, those kind
like
of
maintain things. Some distance.
You maintain some distance, not become too friendly. I have seen a lot of young girls who starts traveling. They become too friendly. Now, being friendly and being respectful to people is completely all right. But you have to know where to draw that boundary, where you have to, you know, say that, okay, I don't have to be over friendly. Because accept it or not, in India, it is, you know, men usually take it, you know, like if I'm being too friendly, they do understand it in other ways and they misinterpret many times. And also you have to understand, see, you're not always traveling in urban spaces. You're also traveling in rural areas. So there, if you're too frank or too friendly, then they might misinterpret that thing. So you have to maintain a distance, as you rightly said.
Yes, we just have one addition from Tales from Aru. She says, first thing I would say is remove the fear word from your mind.
Definitely. She is absolutely correct. And she is a seasoned traveler herself. And
hi, Aru.
Aarti has traveled extensively. So, you know, you are safe wherever you go and you're unsafe wherever you go. So it's all in your perception, you know. You know, when you go to a new place, it seems unsafe because you don't know that space. Now, when somebody says, you know, Delhi is unsafe, trust me, I have never felt that Delhi is unsafe because I know this is my home. You know, I know where to go. I know what to wear. I know how to talk to people. Right. So I have never felt it is unsafe. But if I go to any other place which is new for me, I will be a little cautious. So one thing I always advise to, you know, men, women, both, whenever you're traveling, always make sure that you don't reach the destination at night. That is my advice to each one, you know, whoever is traveling. Because what happens, especially for women, if you're traveling at night and if you're reaching at night, you don't know whether you will get, you know, the transport. You don't know, you know, what kind of area you're going to go. So, you know, that is something I always avoid. So I always take a, you know, early morning flight or take an overnight bus so that I reach in the morning. Because you have more options also at that time.
Do you book in advance, like your accommodation and your entire tour? Or is it not always? Okay.
No, not the whole tour. But yes, accommodation, usually I book it in advance. But there have been instances where I have not booked and I was always able to find a place. So, you know, don't always think that you will never find a place. You will always find a place to stay. Maybe it will be below your expectation, but you will always find a place to stay. Other than accommodation, I don't book anything else, obviously, other than the transport also. But most of the times, you know, I go there, I figure out what to do. And sometimes if I feel like just staying in, I will just stay in. Or just go to one place and just sit there for a while and not do anything. Like, I have visited Ladakh like twice. And I have never seen
already.
I have never seen Shanti Stupa. Like, I stayed where Shanti Stupa was, but it's the famous landmark. But I have never been there because I never felt like it. So, you know.
Because you see it so much already being in the spotlight, then it loses, sometimes it loses the charm also.
Yeah.
You already have seen it. You've already read about it so much. Okay. Since you're talking about traveling, making your travel plans, you are working full time and you are managing to travel. How do you do this? I read in one of your blogs you've written about not quitting your job to travel.
Yeah, to travel.
Tell us a little more about that. How do you manage them?
And you know, it's more relevant in these times. Like, I can imagine people, what they are going through, who does not, you know, have a secure income. For me, that is very important, you know, to have a secure income. So I will never leave my job. Many times, a lot of people have told me that, you know, you have a you have a long standing blog, why don't you go into it, and you know so many people, you should do it. But I don't want to do it, first because it will take away the fun out of travel. Travel is like, you know, my escape. It is something that keeps me excited. But if I keep on doing it as a job, then I have to find something else that is fun for me. So, you know, the job, being a teacher, it keeps me stable. It gives me a stable income. It gives me a routine, which I really like. I don't, it really disturbs me, you know, all those sudden changes. So I like that stability a lot. And
so this is the comfort which strengthens you, and then you have your own,
then
you
I have your my choice. Own things. Yes. Because, you know, I get bored very easily, so I need to do something or the other. But at least at the backhand, I know, okay, I have a stable job. And with that, I can do a lot of things. How do I manage my travel is, I have a very understanding principle, first of all. So, you know, whenever I need leaves, she has always been very, very supportive of my travels. Because she herself also is a traveler. She enjoys traveling a lot. So I think because of that, she has been very supportive. So taking
so find a boss who will support you.
So, you know, finding leaves or taking leaves has never been a problem. Plus, I'm into that kind of profession where we do get a lot of leaves. You being a teacher, we all agree to that. We have our summer break. We have our winter break, you know, all that stuff. Also, even weekends whenever I have, so I will always try to plan it. So if I have a long weekend and if I can take one more day off, how I can club it with things like, you know, to make it a long vacation. Also, what I do extra duties at times to take comp ops.
Okay.
So, you know, whenever the CBSE papers are going on, I will always request for an extra duty. So, you know, that time I can work, and then later on I can take a comp off, so I can club it. So that strategy has really, you know, helped me a lot in planning my vacation.
So again, coming back to planning in advance and scheduling all of your tasks so that you're able to totally 100% give justify your job and also still continue with doing
this. You know, I think I'm better at my job because of my traveling. Because I'm not frustrated at the end of the day. You know, I enjoy working. I enjoy being a teacher. I love my presence in the class. And, you know, I really enjoy the interaction that I have with my students. So the traveling, it rejuvenates me. So every month, every, you know, 2 months or whenever I get to travel, I come back with new energy. And that I can give it to my students, you know. So that makes it a lot better and gives a perfect balance to, you know, work and play.
I'm
everything.
Sure your students must be waiting to hear new stories. Every time you go out, you must be coming back with a bag full of things to tell them.
Yeah, a lot of them are stalkers, okay? A lot of them, you know, secretly they will
they find
know,
out.
Check out my Instagram, and then very smugly in the class, oh, ma'am, you went there. What did you do? Things like that. So that's, I think that also helps me in building a good rapport with my students.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. We have one more comment from Aarti. Her blog is kick-ass and so much info. And that is so true. Travel at your own pace.
Thank you so much, Aarti.
Okay, we're just saying hi to everybody. All those who have joined now and who are watching, we are live with Suman, and we're talking about traveling and we're talking about mental health together. Next question.
Yes.
Why travel? I think you've spoken about this. How to... Ziba. That is...
Ziba is all active.
Yes. Very, absolutely. That is... what variable? Your extraneous variable.
Extraneous
out of control. How to get paid to travel? Do you approach people? Do they approach you? How do you start?
It happens both ways. When you start as a blogger, you have to approach people because by that time nobody knows you. So you need to build your profile. And also a lot of, you know, influencers who writes on their profiles that they are a blogger but don't have a blog. That does not count as a blogger, right? So you need to have content. You need to have a blog to be called a blogger. Right. So once you build up that profile, you can start approaching people, which I have also done over the years. You can approach people in the hospitality sector. You can approach people in tourism boards. You know, things like that. You can approach people. Once you establish yourself, then obviously, you know, people get to know about you and they will approach you from their side. But you know, it's always two ways how you want to do it. So, but your profile is very, very important. You have to, you know, your work has to speak for you. So, if you're writing about travel, you have to also pick up a niche for yourself. What do you want to write? Right? So, a lot of hard work goes into, you know, being a blogger. It's just not, the traveling part, because even when you're traveling, you have to be conscious about a lot of things because you want to write about them. You have to make notes at times. So usually I take pictures and you know that becomes like a archive sort of a thing. So whenever I'm writing my blogs, I refer to the pictures. Plus having a blog, the website takes a lot of effort. So you know, yeah, buying a domain name and you know, maintaining and updating and all that stuff. So for me, my husband does all the technical work. So I'm a bit, yeah, I'm a bit technically challenged. So
Thank you to
you
Mr. Suman for making this happen.
So I had a blog even before I met him, but it was like on Blogspot and it was like very general. But he has helped me to build up, you know, the profile and how to write because he works with SEO and you know things like that. So there are a lot of tools available which you know budding bloggers can look out for, and they can install it you know as you know as attachments in their blog, which will you know help them in writing. Like I use a tool called Yoast, YOAST, Yoast. So that helps me when I'm writing because it tells me that as per Google, as per SEO, you know what are the mistakes I'm making, is my sentences too long, or do I need a subheading? So it gives like a you know constant like an English
Ziba, 2 minutes. Give me 2 minutes, mama.
an
Sorry.
English teacher on your head who will you know keep on correcting you if you're going wrong. So that's a very good tool that people can use. Also, you have to be very regular on social media with your presence. So you have to keep posting about stuff, about places. Also, again, as I said before, you have to choose what is your niche. Like I see a lot of you know budding bloggers, they're writing about a place, but they're always posting pictures, you know, their own pictures. So you know, for me, that's a no-no. Like I just want like one good picture from a trip. That's all for me. But for me, other than that, it's about you know the people I meet and the places that I go to, and I want to document that even on my profile. So I think we have to keep in mind that why are you traveling and what is it giving you? So you know.
Absolutely, and it's not you that is you are showcasing. You are showcasing your travels,
Yeah,
what you are
it is. It
learning.
is your interpretation about your travel. So I was talking about you know how I went to Bastar Dashera last year, and there you know they do animal sacrifice. So I posted, I witnessed it, and I clicked a picture and I posted on my social media, and I got a lot of negative feedback from people that why are you posting such a picture? Now, my idea of posting that picture was not to hurt anybody's sentiments. It's not that I support animal sacrifice or something like that. But if I'm going to a place, I'm experiencing their culture, right? So I have to project that in its, you know, in its totality. I don't want to only show you the good things about a culture. I also want to show you all the other aspects that people actually don't know about. So, you know, I think those things are very important.
We will go into a rapid fire, okay? That is a surprise. Suman doesn't know about it. But last question before that. Your most cherished tour, your most cherished place, or something which happened
Place.
during the travel.
Okay. There are so many, you know, it's very difficult to
First thing that comes to
choose.
your mind.
I love Arunachal. So, you know, the back-breaking trips on a local cab has always been, you know, I feel when things go wrong in a trip, that is what you remember throughout your life. When everything goes as planned, I never remember it. But it's all the bad things that, you know, that happens during a trip that makes a trip memorable. So, you know, Arunachal was extremely beautiful and I had a blast. A lot of things went wrong. I had a AMS attack, so I was unable to breathe because of the altitude. But, you know, and I always felt that, you know, I am fit and I love the mountains and nothing will happen to me. But you never know how AMS is going to affect you. So then, you know, whenever you're going to a place, you should always do some amount of research so that, you know what to expect in that place. So after that
is why you wrote a blog, so other people can be prepared.
Yeah, definitely. Yes. Because, you know, when I went to Ladakh for the first time, so Ladakh was my first solo trip. So before that, I did not know what AMS is. I did not know how to go. I just reached Manali and I went straight away to Ladakh. And throughout the trip, I was very uncomfortable. I had indigestion. I had a little bit of temperature. My head was paining. I was unable to sleep. And I did not know why that was happening. It was only after a few years that I came to know, okay, altitude, mountain sickness, you know, there's something like that. And I wrote that post to inform and give information to people that, you know, this is a condition that might happen. So it's not, and when it happens, you need to seek the correct medical help.
Yes. Like these are small symptoms, but then they can have a severe effect if you don't know about it or you don't know what to do about it.
You know, I always suggest people when they ask about Ladakh, that always take the road to Ladakh. I understand people do not have so much time to travel by road. So a lot of people go by flight. And just because they have 4 or 5 days, they end up landing and they start exploring. You should always give 1 day's break to your body to, you know, get adjusted to the altitude. Otherwise, you know, I have had friends who went and came back the next day because they could not take the altitude.
You need time. It's nature, right? You need give nature a chance to get acclimatized. Give your body a chance to do that also. Okay. Rapid fire. Okay. This will take maybe a minute or so. Very simple questions. Sumar, are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. First question. Cats or dogs?
Dogs.
Tea or coffee?
Tea.
Beaches or mountains?
Mountains.
a quote you live by or a quote that you often think about?
Everybody wants to be somebody, but nobody wants to grow.
Okay, good. Teaching or traveling?
Okay. Teaching supports my traveling, so I would take teaching.
Okay, fine. Current show you're watching?
I just started with Hinterland. So it's a new, you know, show, a detective. So I like a lot of thrillers. So I'm watching that these days.
Okay, fine. Yeah. A book every travel lover should read.
Wild. I think Wild was a very nice book.
Okay. Next destination on your list when all this opens up?
All this opens up. I'm going to go to Manali. Manali is like my go-to place.
Okay. One thing every traveler should do while traveling to new places?
Research a bit before you go.
Okay. Fine.
Research.
Last question.
Which,
Yes. Research and plan. Yes.
Yeah. Definitely.
Right? Last question. A word of encouragement to our viewers.
Don't be scared to travel. Don't say that you don't have time for traveling. It depends on you, you know, how you want to prioritize things in your life. If you want to do something, you should just go ahead and do it.
Yes, that's very important. Okay.
Yes.
If you want to do it, we make it happen.
Yes,
somehow
definitely.
You figure it out. Yes, you
definitely.
Figure it out. Okay, that was lovely, Suman. Thank you very much for agreeing to do this with me. And I had a fun chat. And seeing you after so long, that itself
I know,
was fun.
It's been so long.
I know, we again, for those of you who are new, who are just joining and who don't know what we were up to, we met during CBSE board checking, and that's how we got to know each other. And that's how Suman told me to work on my profile, and she asked me to do certain things. It is very difficult. You're talking about blogging and all those things. Very, very difficult. unless and until you really, really want to make these things happen, they don't just happen overnight. Like, we see the success that we see, which is very visible, but there's so much which is happening behind the scenes, which people like Suman, they make those things happen. So thank you very much.
Most welcome.
Yeah. Anything you want to say before we finish?
Nothing as such. I just want to say that, you know, everyone should stay safe. You know, traveling is something that will make your life beautiful. So you should not be scared of it. You should not be scared of traveling alone. Like, a lot of people are scared of traveling alone. So I want to encourage them. You're never alone when you travel, because when you're traveling, you will meet so many other people, you know, who are also traveling alone. Yes. And that bonding of, you know, traveling together is, I think, something that is very beautiful, and you will only enjoy it when you travel alone.
Yes, absolutely. Chalo, on that note, we'll wind up today's. Okay, all of the people who are messaging and sending us lots of love, thank you very, very much. I hope you all had fun. And Suman, take care of yourself too. Until next time. Okay. And we will be looking forward to the next vlog now. Manali, right?
Yes. Yes.
Chalo. Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Have a good evening.